snap, right? That's two. That's three. That's good. I was behind on that one. The creepy and the kooky. Come on, Amirius and Hooky. They're all together kooky. The Addams family. Very good. Their house is a museum. When people come to see them, they really are a scream. The Addams family. Meet. Sweet. Petite. So get a witch you saw on, a Brewster you can call on. We're gonna make a call on the Addams family. All right, so that's that. That was written, by the way, by a guy named Vic Mizzi. And he also wrote the song for Green Acres, which is also a great song. And if you watch both of those shows, you'll see there's music played throughout the entire episode. It's not just a theme song, but there's music played throughout. So he was famous for those two songs. So let me start with something. I wrote this back in 1992, and this has been used ever since. It's on the website of Westfield. And what I wanted to do is just kind of read what I did that long ago and then kind of update it and fill in some of the gaps along the way. Charles Samuel Addams, or Chill, as his friends called him, was born January 7, 1912 in Westfield, New Jersey. Records show at the time of his birth, Addams lived on Summit Avenue. They moved several times before taking a permanent residence in 1920 on Elm Street and stayed there until 1947. He attended public school in Westfield and was fond of visiting the Presbyterian Cemetery on Mountain Avenue. When he was a youngster, he was caught by the police for breaking into a house on Dudley Avenue. On the second floor of a garage behind the main house, there's a chalk drawing of a skeleton, which is believed to have been drawn by Charles Addams. That house on Dudley Avenue and one of the houses on Elm Street is said to be the inspiration for the famous Addams Family House. At Westfield High, Charles became the art editor for the Weather Vane and drew many cartoons. He graduated in 1929 and attended Colgate University. He then went and switched to University of Pennsylvania and then studied at the Grand Central School of Art in New York City. His dream was to work for the New Yorker magazine and started submitting cartoons as early as 1935. His very first one was entitled I Forgot My Skates. And in 1940, he submitted Downhill Skier, which is one of his more famous cartoons that has ever been drawn, and I'll show you that later, and got him a permanent job at the New Yorker magazine. He continued there until his death in 1988, drawing over 1,300 cartoons. And out of those 1,300, believe it or not, less than 2% was of the Addams family. On occasion, he did work for other magazines such as Collier's and TV Guide. So that's what I did in 1992. Let me fill in a little bit more of the gaps. Yes, he was born January 7, 1912, and the house that he was born at, because back then a lot of babies were born at the home itself instead of going to the hospital, it was 511 Summit Avenue. Now, 511 Summit Avenue doesn't exist anymore. They tore that down. I believe, according to Ralph Jones, who is with the Historic Society, there was the original Lincoln School, which was on that location, and then later on they moved Lincoln School farther down. It then became the Masonic Temple, and that building stood for many, many years. Then they tore that down, and now there are houses there. So that actual address doesn't exist anymore. But the records show us that the Addams moved several times. They also lived 98 Park Avenue, they lived 534 Clark Street, and then eventually residing at 522 Elm Street. He graduated Westfield High in 1929, and he was a cartoonist for the Weather Vane, which he drew several original cartoons. He also attended more than one college. He attended Colgate University, which was funny because when you said your husband attended, according to his biography, they said that back in those days, it's like everybody that was from Westfield, they all went to Colgate University. So it was like an automatic thing that everybody else went, so he went. I don't know the exact story of why he only stayed there 1 year, but he switched to the University of Pennsylvania. There's a house on that campus. They swear that that's the Addams Family House. Everybody wants to claim credit for the Addams Family House. But then he also left there, and then he ended up going to the Grand Central School of Art, which I was told was on one of the upper floors of Grand Central Station. And the story goes that he would get so bored with classes, because after a while, he was learning how to draw, he felt he had that down, he'd go down to the and just sit and watch people. And sometimes he drew cartoons of Grand Central Station, which again had great perspective, great lighting. He was really, well, I feel personally, well advanced at his time for drawing the cartoons that he did. He also worked for several magazines, although the New Yorker is probably the most famous magazine that he worked for. He also worked for True Detective. Now, the True Detective back then was kind of almost like what the Inquirer has become. It was very racy. They had deaths and murders and everything. And what he would do, he'd go in and touch up the drawings and make it look more gory, put more blood or whatever, which fits him perfectly to what he eventually, but he did that for a while. And then he also worked for Cosmopolitan Magazine, which this was back in the days of the 1920s, Collier's, TV Guide, and then of course, the New Yorker Magazine, where he probably gained his biggest reputation. He loved being married. In fact, he was married 3 times. He liked it so much. He first married Barbara Day, who was also from Westfield. Did you really? Feel free to speak out anytime you want, all right? Don't hesitate. This side too, you want to say anything? No, go ahead, whatever you want to say. So you knew Barbara Day?
Yeah.
Oh, great.
Not well, but I
right, okay. From what I was told, Barbara Day and his second wife, who was also named Barbara, looked very similar. They were tall and thin and had dark hair. And does that sound like anyone?
Yeah.
Right, exactly. So he was attracted to that type of woman and he drew that type of woman. When were they married? Where were they married? Okay, you have to leave the room because you don't know these answers. They were married May 29th, 1943 at St. Paul's Church, right here in town. So that was his first marriage. In 1954, he married Barbara Barb on December 1st, 1954. Now, Barbara was pretty smart, was really, I think, the most intellectual of all the wives, because she realized how good this guy was. and she was also a lawyer, and she made sure while they were married, she got the rights to all his cartoons. So anything that was the TV series, anything that was done, she made sure she was a percentage of that. So she was the only one that, I don't know whether Barbara Day, it was too young in their marriage or their life for him to realize, but by 1954, she was well aware how good this guy was and made sure that anything that, it all went through her. I mean, he got his part, but she made sure everything was done. And then in May 31st, 1980, he married for a final time to a woman named Marilyn T. Adams, and they were married in a pet cemetery, which is kind of fun. They lived out in Long Island, and what she did, she ended up owning the rights to anything other than the artwork. So any toys that were made or anything else that were done, she got a part of that. She also formed a foundation called the Charles Addams and T. Adams Foundation, which also goes to help support his foundation of all his artwork and galleries. Now, the very first Addams Family cartoon, and I put Addams Family in quotes because he started drawing cartoons in the 1930s. He did this for several years before the TV show. The characters never had names. You'll never see a name referred to another character in the cartoons, ever. They were not even called the Addams Family. It was just this creepy little family. But the first one appeared August 6th, 1938. So that means for 70 years now, we've been watching and enjoying the Addams Family. The interesting thing I said before about 1,300 cartoons, 2% the Addams Family, although it was a small percentage of his work, every single book he put out has the Addams Family on the cover. So he knew that's what drew people to him. But once you got into those cartoons, you saw a lot of things. I mean, he made political comments, he made comments about society, he made comments about just different things that were going on, and I'll share some of those cartoons that I feel that he did maybe 40, 50, 60 years ago could have been drawn this week. I mean, that's how far in advance he would think about different political and commentary. The first one, 1938. His first book of cartoons was called Drawn and Quartered. Now, I know, Lauren, do you know if we had that? This is Lauren Ryan, by the way. She's in the back, works for the public library. Do we have that here at the library? Okay. He put out a total of 13 books. And the first one was Drawn and Quartered. And it also has a foreword by Boris Karloff.
Oh, wow.
Yes. Now, Boris Karloff was friends with Bennett Cerf, and Bennett Cerf worked at Random House, and that's where the first book was published. So, as a friend, he said, can you write the foreword for the book? So here's just a small portion of what Karloff said, and then I'll illustrate even further how important Boris Karloff and Addams were to each other. So Karloff wrote, I hope I will not be accused of undue vanity if I publicly thank Mr. Addams for immortalizing me in the person of the witch's butler. So again, not a name, not a first name or a last name, but called the witch and just the witch's butler. So all that stuff, all those things we're familiar with came many, many years later in 1964. The total titles of all his books, if anyone wants to write these down, if there are titles that you're looking for, he did again total 13. First one was called Drawn and Quartered. Then he did Addams and Evil, Monster Alley, Homebodies, Nightcrawlers, Dear Dead Days, Black Mariah, The Groaning Board, Charles Addams' Mother Goose, My Crowd, Favorite Haunts, Creature Comforts, and then the book that was published after he died was called The World of Charles Addams. Now, I have a trivia contest for all you here. I'm going to name each member of the family, but you have to tell me what their names are. For example, who was the mother? Morticia, right. And specifically because of Mortician. He wanted that parallel. What was the father's name? Gomez. That, according to stories, was picked out by John Aston. He just, I think he was given a couple choices, and Aston says, I want Gomez. I like that the best. What was the daughter's name? Wednesday. And Wednesday, because of the poem, Wednesday's child is full of woe. How about the son? Pugsley. He wanted to first call him Pubic. And the censor said, no, that's not going to go too well. So he changed it to Pugsley, thank goodness. How about the grandmother?
Mama.
Grandmama, right, exactly. How about the cousin?
It.
Right, the little furry guy, remember him? He was played by a guy named Felix Selleck, I think, and he does a lot of these memorabilia shows. He's still alive, and he goes around and he signs autographs, but he's like 3 feet tall. Who was the hired hand? No. He was the butler. Thing, very good, Thing. The hired hand, the hand that came out of the box. And who's the butler? Lurch, right. Now, interesting trivia about Lurch and Thing. On occasion, they would appear in scenes, but most of the time they were not in the same scenes. The reason being is Ted Cassidy, who played the butler, also played Thing. So his hand, when you saw his hand come out, it was his hand. But on occasion when they were in the same scene, then they would have another actor do it. Now, let me show you some cartoons, and we'll start off. And I hope, I don't know if you can see it too well in the back there, but what I did is I drew up a map of Westfield, and I've done this by memory, so I apologize if I'm out of proportion or missing a street. But here's East Broad Street here, and what we are is we're further down the street to Elm. Here's Dudley Avenue up here, East Broad. Here's Dudley here. Here's Elm Street. Here's Central Avenue. Here's Lawrence and Mountain, okay? Charles Addams grew up at 522 Elm Street, and that is the house that has been dedicated as a landmark, and there's a plaque on the house that says this is where Charles Addams lived. On this corner, right now it's the Board of Ed building, but back in 1929 it was the Westfield High School, okay? For 4 years, every day, he walked from his house to school. Across the street is 411 Elm Street. And that's the house I believe was the inspiration for the Addams Family House. Because if you look at that house, it looks like the Addams Family House. It has the mansard roof. And I just personally believe every day he just saw it. Wow, that's a neat house. And I think he used that as the Addams Family House. Over here on Mountain Avenue is the cemetery that we had talked about. And he would roam, so if you can see, it's walking distance from his house. He'd walk there sometimes on rainy days and just walk around. He loved cemeteries. He would always imagine what people looked like under the ground. Now, around the corner from him, there's a house. I don't know the exact address. Maybe somebody here does. But there was a house on Dudley, still there, and behind it, back then, I think it was a barn. It's now a garage. But on the second floor is that famous skeleton. that he drew that, I believe, is still there. And from what I was told, he used to pal around with a bunch of kids, and they used to, like, all hang out together, all within the same area. So it is believable to know they used to hang out in this structure and then go up and play and whatever. And this is also the house he broke into when it was empty and was caught by the police. So that house is very important to him. Now, what I also drew on this map is the Rialto Theater and John Franks. And that's very important because on occasion, he loved Westfield so much, he actually put Westfield in some of his cartoons, which I'll show you as well. Now, this is the drawing that I swear could have been written this week. It is a woman sitting with an investor, a Wall Street investor, to invest money. And she's concerned, and he says the following. He says, "There's no cause for public, Mrs. Munson, but frankly, there are certain indicators that cannot be ignored." And then if you look out the window, you'll see four guys about to jump off the building. And he wrote that 40, 50 years ago. That's a funny cartoon. That's a funny cartoon today. It's a funny cartoon when it was first drawn. He also did a great cartoon, which I didn't bring with me, but, and this could have been written back when Exxon Valdez happened. There's a beautiful lake. All the little boys are putting in sailboats. And this one kid's putting in a tugboat, and there's oil, an oil trail all behind the whole thing. So again, it's I don't know how he could think of these things, how far in advance, but he was just a wonderful cartoonist, had a wonderful mind, and always thought outside the box. So that's one of my favorites. So in flipping through the cartoons I was going to show today, I go, let me show this one, because this one I think is relative to today as well. Here is our famous cartoon that is celebrating its 70th anniversary. This is the very first Addams Family cartoon that he drew. There's Morticia, there's Lurch, but if you see, he's different. He doesn't look the same that he looked eventually. And here's a funny little thing too. You see this little person up here on the balcony peering in? He did this in several cartoons. This to me was similar to what Al Hirschfeld would do with Nina. You know, Nina, he did it once or twice, then all of a sudden he started to. If you get a chance, the next time you see an Addams Family cartoon, look. Once in a while, he throws this little person. He never identifies who that person is. It's hard even sometimes to tell whether it's a man or a woman, but just that little person peering over, and I'm not too sure who that is, but the point of the cartoon, the thing that makes it funny is, again, you see a bat flying, there's cobwebs, and here's a vacuum cleaner salesman trying to sell her a vacuum. So that's the funny part of the cartoon, which, again, he drew just one time, just to do it as a cartoon, but you take a look at the butler, and I will show you a picture of Boris Karloff. He played a butler in a film called The Old Dark House. And if you look at it next to that, that's what he was doing. He took that look of Boris Karloff and turned it into the butler. So that's what he did. Then later on, he changed the look of Lurch, who looked more like the Frankenstein monster with the flat head and the high cheekbones. And if you then compare it to what Karloff also did, then you see. To me, in my opinion, he was really doing a tribute to Boris Karloff, who played two different roles in two different films, instead of just doing the Frankenstein monster. So I think it's great that that's what he did. I'm a huge Karloff fan as well, and it's nice to know that they even had that brief relationship with that foreword that Karloff wrote. Now, here are some other cartoons, which again, might be hard for you to see. In fact, what I'd like to do, way in the back, I see that there's a long table. I will put all these cartoons out so everyone can take a look at them, because in the front here, we just don't have any room. But this is a cartoon where a couple's driving through town, and just the caption is, "It's the town the time forgot." And the thing that makes it special is you will see the Rialto Theater in here. You will also see a building that says J. Franks, Men's Clothing, which obviously was John Franks. So here you have two Westfield landmarks within one cartoon, which again, obviously was a nod to Westfield. Now, you may know this, but I don't know about anybody else. Here's a cartoon where two guys are walking by a, a stock exchange firm. And the firm is called Gordon, Boughton, and Reed. Now, do you know why there's a Westfield connection there? He went to school with three people. He went to school with Gordon, Boughton, and Reed. So those people that grew up with him knew him, knew that these names were those names from Westfield. But anybody else watching the cartoon wouldn't know about it. But these are guys that I grew up with. In fact, Dick Boughton, I don't know whether he's still alive or not, but in 1992, when the film came out, when I first started doing all this stuff, he was alive, and he was wonderful to talk to and loved to talk all about Charles Addams. So those three names are Westfield names. And the thing that I love the most about the Addams family is it's still with us. It's never going to go away. And I'm sure you've all seen the cartoons on television with M&Ms, and they do the exact theme song. They don't change a word. Nothing has changed, and they've all taken the M&Ms and made it all different characters of the M&Ms. And that's what I love about Charles Addams. He's never going to go away. Every October, we'll think about him. Every October, hopefully, there'll be more things to talk about and do about Charles Addams. Okay? Now, I also have a dream of my own that I would like someday for us in Westfield to do a little bit more for him so that people really know that there's that connection between Charles Addams and Westfield. Mark Twain, some of you might know, grew up in Missouri. But there's a Mark Twain house. And do you know where that is? Where? No. No. Hartford, Connecticut. I don't know. I mean, he did live there for a few years. But again, nothing in Missouri. Charles Schulz, do you know where he grew up? Minnesota. Do you know where the Charles Schulz house is? Santa Rosa, California. Doesn't make sense. We have the birthplace of Charles Addams. He went to school here. He got married here. He's put cartoons with Westfield landmarks. We're just not, I think, doing enough. I wish we would. I wish the, you know, maybe on your own, being Westfield citizens, contact the mayor, contact Downtown Westfield Corporation, contact the Westfield Historic Society. I would love for us to be known more as the home of Charles Addams. I know that the Westfield Historic Society is trying to open up a house on Mountain Avenue. See, to me, it would be wonderful to put a sign on there saying, home of Charles Addams and the Addams family. That would grow attention. That would have people want to stop and visit. Well, I am realistic, so I'm willing to wait for 3 years. Because 3 years will be the 100th birthday of Charles Addams that we could celebrate. So there's no reason in 3 years, hopefully, we can get enough. I mean, I would love to have signs made up saying, you know, Westfield, a family town, an Addams family town. You know, to have people know that connection. There's also, there's hundreds of merchandise out there that can be bought that, to me, every store should be carrying. And so, especially just even in the month of October alone. I mean, there's no reason why we should not have that connection of Charles Addams. He's a wonderful cartoonist, way ahead of his time, got many, many awards and honors during his lifetime. There's no reason why we cannot do that. So let me continue to this table over here. One of the things that I've had a chance to do is create a scholarship. And this book is brand new. It came out last year. It's written by Linda Davis. Every book is signed by the artist. And what I'm doing is I'm telling them for $50 and 100% goes to the Charles Addams Scholarship. What we did with the scholarship, it started in 1992, was the first year we gave it out. And it goes to a person that is majoring in art. So with the donation, you're honoring also the arts and education at the same time. The thing that I'd love to know is 1992 was the first one, and Addams graduated in 1929. So it's the same numbers, but in reverse. So that was nice to know. And that person, by the way, his name is Seth Piazzas. He just contacted me. He now works for the Cartoon Network. He has his own company. So from that first award, that scholarship has now gone to somebody that's professionally in the business. What I also do here is I have some trading cards that were put out several years ago. Thank goodness they don't have gum. God knows what the gum would taste like. But these are a dollar a piece. So if you want to donate a dollar, just take a pack of cards. We'll put that and we'll give that to this scholarship as well. The scholarship, by the way, is tax deductible. You get a thank you card from the Westfield Foundation. You can write it off on your taxes. The Westfield Foundation, I don't know how many people out there are familiar with the Westfield Foundation or not, but I have an address for them as well. If somebody would like to just even send a letter or whatever, it's the Westfield Foundation, and their mailing address is P.O. Box 2295, and it's Westfield, New Jersey, and it's 07091. So, are there any questions at all? Something maybe I didn't discuss or talk about? Yes, go ahead. Okay, he divorced each time, but I apologize, although T. Addams ended up outliving him because he died in 1988. Oh, thank you so much, because I've forgotten some other things too. He dated some pretty famous women. You want to hear this list? Anybody here, Greta Garbo?
No.
Okay.
Social,
Joan Fontaine? How about Jackie Onassis? These were some of the women that he was known to go out with and date. His first wife, they divorced, Barbara Day. I think, I'm not too sure what happened to Barbara Day. Barbara Barb, he divorced, but then she ended up marrying some royalty in England, and she then was known as Lady Collington. And I ended up meeting her and knowing her. She was a very delightful woman. In fact, at the University of Pennsylvania, I don't know how many millions of dollars, but there's an actual Charles Addams wing at the University of Pennsylvania that she made sure that all happened. And then T. Addams did outlive him. He died in 1988, but then she has passed away since then as well. In 1988, he was working on an Addams Family Broadway show. And it's finally going to happen. It'll be out, I think, by the end of next year, 2009. So it took 20 years, but it's got a great team behind it, a lot of people that have been involved in Broadway for a long, long time. So I'm looking forward to that. That should be lots of fun. So yeah, so that's the answer. So the first two divorces and the last one became his widow. Yes, go ahead. No, he never did. He never did. I think his first wife wanted to have children. Did he have any children at all? No, no descendants at all. And as far as I know, no other relative whatsoever. In fact, the spelling is very unique. It's A-D-D-A-M-S. You know, most people, when I first say I'm a Charles Addams historian, they go, oh yeah, the president. I go, no, not him. But he spells it differently. And how about some of the old timers in Westfield? What used to be the code for the phone numbers?
Adams.
My phone number was Adams 34879. Right. So it's kind of funny that that became the code for the thing. So no children. I think his first wife couldn't have children, and then I think they tried to adopt, and something happened, and then that just. He liked going out to parties. In fact, the New York Public Library has a special connection to Adams because when he died, he absolutely listed, I do not want a funeral, I want a party. And that's where they had the party. They had live music, they had champagne and wine and whatever, and they had a party, and that's exactly how he wanted to do it. He wanted a party night. And then a few years ago, they had, in fact, I think it's in the display case that's out in the lobby there, they had a whole retrospective of his cartoons, and they did a wonderful thing at the New York Public Library. So that was wonderful to see as well. Anyone else? And thank you very much.
Thank you.
And spooky, they're all together ooky, the Addams Family. The house is a museum, when people come to see them, they really are a scream, the Addams Family.
Neat, sweet,